Hello, girls, guys, or otherwise, this is Rich with your Christo-Pagan Sunday. Trying a little bit different of a setup. I'm a little bit lower than I was in the previous video. Let's see if we can just do some movie magic. There we go. Okay. Instead of trying to reposition everything, I just brought the recliner that they, or the little, like, you know, regular reclining chair that they have in the hotel here. I brought that over to the desk because it's going to be a lot easier. Just trust me. And I got this nice little thing, this little lap desk thing here. So we are actually going to do a little bit of a dive into some verses in Wisdom of Syriac. So I didn't actually have a lesson planned for this Christo-Pagan Sunday, nothing specific. So I decided to do a little bibliomancy and see what lessons came from the scriptures and, you know, what I kind of ascertained from the scriptures. So, and I keep on bumping the mic here, and I do apologize. Let me try to see. I don't want to put it up too high. Hopefully that's okay there. And hopefully I won't bump it too much more. Anyway, I am reading from the Orthodox Study Bible. Let's see if I can get a shot of that. Okay, there it is. Orthodox Study Bible. I do like this Bible in particular, and I actually copied down the verses, so I didn't have to have that out the entire time. But I do like that Bible because it has a lot of different books that are actually not in the run-of-the-mill, regular Protestant Bible, and some of the books that are not in the Catholic Bible. So I wanted to have that. And so, yeah, I have them written down here. And my bibliomancy brought me to Wisdom of Syriac, chapter 51, which is at the very end of the book. Verses 19 and 20 through 21. And this part of the chapter speaks specifically on wisdom. And I'm just going to read them and then we'll get into everything. It reads, "My soul strove earnestly for her and examined myself closely in my performance of the law. I stretched out my hands to the heights and mourned my ignorance to her. I dedicated my soul to her, and in purification I found her. I acquired a heart for her from the beginning. Therefore, I was not forsaken. My heart was stirred to search for her, and therefore I gained a good possession." So I've actually taken the verse 19, I broke it into four different parts. Verse 20, I broke into four different parts. And verse 21, I broke into two parts. And I want to examine each one of those individually or as a smaller grouping. So this passage, for one, is speaking about wisdom, and it's personifying wisdom, which would be Sophia. The translation in Greek is actually Sophia. And this book in particular was translated from Hebrew to Greek, and I think back into Hebrew. I could be mistaken on that, but that is my understanding. So either way you slice it, the name Sophia, or the embodiment of wisdom as a personification in this book, in this chapter specifically, gives me the notion of a feminine divine, in particular Sophia, the goddess that I have in my pantheon. Now, what I'm going to say here actually, I think, pertains to other divine feminine beings. So if Sophia is not your goddess, don't worry. This, I think, still has nuggets of truth for you as well. So we can all use it and we can all learn from it. So anyway, let's look at these verses, and we're going to try to take out the nuggets of truth here and see what really speaks to us. In verse 19, and I'll read this again, it's just the first portion. My soul strove earnestly for her. This speaks to so many of us in the first portion. So many of us seek out the goddess when we start our practice. We yearn to gain connection to the divine feminine. My practice was a little different starting out. I was interested in spell work and communication with the dead. After about 6 years, I found Sophia for inclusion in my practice. So while many of us, myself excluded on this, but many of us as Christo-Pagans, we strive to have that feminine divine in our practice. And I think this is really concretely put in the first portion of verse 19 here in chapter 51. Moving on, in the next two portions, it reads, "And examined myself closely in my performances, or in my performance of the law. I stretched out my hands to the heights." And we'll stop there for a second. And I have written here, the next two portions of this verse speak to how we should examine our own lives, beliefs, and practices before assuming that a goddess will fix all of our problems. I think that a portion or a part of this is aligned with how the church tends to teach, you know, laying down all your troubles at the feet of deity and then going about your merry way. Rather than relying on deity to fix all of our problems, we need to examine and make sure our own actions in day-to-day life is squared with our beliefs. When we are adequately prepared, keep in mind we will all fail at some time, and some of us, you know, fail a lot, like myself. I'm sure that I fall short quite often. Whenever we reach that point that we're prepared, we can raise our arms and rejoice that the divine feminine is there for us. She is there to guide and assist us in our journey, as long as if we are willing to do the work. There is something with the teachings of the church, or how it's being taught in a majority of church settings, especially in like evangelical denominations, where they're like, oh, just lay it at the feet of the cross and you'll be fine, or just rely on God and you'll be fine. And it's like, at what point are we taking personal responsibility for what we are doing as individuals? Are we here to learn lessons? Are we here to actually do better? Or are we here just to, you know, be little playthings, and whatever we do, we just keep going and running back to deity saying, hey, here's all my problems, fix them for me, rather than taking, you know, control and fixing them ourselves? Because we are human beings that are here for a purpose, and we need to be able to fix these things. Some of them are unfixable by us, and I fully recognize that. You know, sometimes there's things that are out of our control and we need divine intervention. However, there are people who will constantly go to deity and say, I'm having problems with this, please fix it for me. And they do that with everything. And I think there's a problem in that whenever you're not taking responsibility for your own actions and taking responsibility for how things turn out because of your actions. So that one got me a little bit there. Let's see. The last portion of verse 19 is, "And mourned my ignorance to her." This last portion of the verse for me is about regret. For many years before my practice, and even those 6 years of my practice prior to including Sophia into my practice, I either denied the existence of the divine feminine or denied the need for her in my practice. I can certainly say that there were many times when I'm like, oh, I don't need a goddess. I don't have to have a goddess in my practice. And it did work fine for me. And what I didn't realize was there is a divine feminine, not because I necessarily need her for spell work, or I don't necessarily need her for spirit communication, but I needed her as a guide, as a way of telling me which way to go to improve myself, to make myself a better person, to be my best self. So that's something that I read into this verse of, "And mourned my ignorance to her," because there were so many wasted years of my life, of my practice, where, yeah, you know, I probably would not trade them because those were important parts of my life and of my practice. But it, looking back, seems like they were wasted, that they were not fulfilling, not as much as my practice is now. But I don't know if changing that, if I would be the person I am today, with having it any different, if that makes sense. So moving on to verse 20, these I have in four parts. The first two and the second two, I'm going to go ahead and read those as two different groups. So, "I directed my soul to her, and in purification I found her." So in verse 20, parts 1 and 2, this reminds me of a dedication ritual and coming to her with a pure heart and intention, rather than coming to her with the intent or motive that does not have an underlying pure reason. And by that I mean, if we are seeking out deity for one reason or another, I have issue with that personally. Now, there are some deity that are like, oh, you know, you need help with spell work? No problem. I'll help you out. It's kind of my thing. But without having that individual, and I'm doing all these hand motions over here and you can't see any of them because the mic's in the way, the mic being in the way. But not having that individual relationship kind of falters. It's kind of like going up to somebody and saying, hey, I need you to do this for me, and I need you to do that for me, and not really having a relationship with them, just treating them like, you know, they're a go-to service. And I have issue with that whenever it comes to deity. And, you know, that's also something I have against many church teachings nowadays, is that we use deity as a vending machine for our problems, and that's an issue. It's supposed to be a relationship, not a vending machine. Now, there are circumstances where if you are working with a deity on something specific, and that deity's like, oh, you know, I'll go ahead and do this. Just, you know, light a candle in my honor, or, you know, leave food out, or leave whiskey out, or, you know, alcohol of some sort, something to imbibe, something to eat, something of a type of sacrifice. And that's fine. If that is your relationship to that deity, is that they're okay delivering on what you need if you give them a sacrifice of sorts, that's fine. But whenever it comes to having a patron deity or a patroness with the divine feminine, I have issue with that, if that's how you are communicating with that divine feminine, using them as a vending machine and saying, hey, I need this, you know, yeah, I'll give you a sacrifice of sorts, and then I'll go about my business. I have issue with that personally. I cannot do that in my practice. If that's your relationship with deity, with the divine feminine in particular, as we are discussing today, then, you know, not exactly my bag, but go ahead for it. At the end of the day, you have to live by your rules and your belief system and your practice, and that's fine. I'm not going to be the one to judge your practice for you. If you want to know my opinion, you just got it, though. Anyway, moving on to the second two verses of verse 20, it says, I acquired a heart for her from the beginning, therefore I was not forsaken. These following two verses would mean acquiring a heart for the divine feminine from the beginning of my dedication to her. Once that dedication took place, I knew that she had my best interests at heart and was watching over me to impart her divine wisdom. Again, you know, Sophia being my matron, you know, the goddess of wisdom and whatnot. That is how I see her, being kind of there to guide, but not tell me specifically, this is what you have to do. At the end of the day, I still make the decisions for my life as myself. And at the end of my lifetime, whenever that comes, I will be judged on how I progressed on certain things that I was supposed to work with, or the certain issues I was supposed to work with in this lifetime, if that makes sense. But Sophia is there having my best interests at heart, knowing my life plan and knowing how I should be progressing on that life path. So she is there to guide me and impart wisdom in order to meet those goals. Again, not as a vending machine, not as as somebody that I run to for everything, but as a way of kind of being a bumper along the road of life. She kind of acts as those bumpers there, saying, you probably shouldn't do this, and steering me in the correct direction. So therefore I was not forsaken, and I don't believe that I would be forsaken, if I follow her advice, especially if I follow her advice. I don't think she would leave me because I didn't follow her advice. I think she would say, okay, you don't want to follow my advice, fine by me, but you're going to learn a lesson, and you may not like the lesson that you have to learn. So, yeah, that's what I have for verse 20. Let's move on to verse 21. I'm going to read both of these. My heart was stirred to search for her, and therefore I gained a good possession. So to me, this verse, verse 21, again of chapter 51 of the Book of Syriac, is basically a synopsis of these three verses, or these other two verses as a whole. My heart being stirred for her, and longing for her, and her coming into my life, and therefore I gained a good possession, the possession of wisdom, or the imparting of wisdom in my life, in my practice, and as a guide for my day-to-day life. So that's what I did for my little bibliomancy, and it was actually like a cathartic, like, couple hours of just delving into these verses and, you know, kind of sitting there and ruminating on them, seeing what they meant for me, and seeing how I could best word this in order to put this in a video for you. So it was about an hour, maybe two, that I spent on that. So let me know in the comments below what you think. Are these verses speaking to you? Are these verses that you have read before? If not, I'm not surprised. It's not a very common book. I don't believe Wisdom of Syriac is in all the other Bibles. Pretty sure it's not. I know the Song of Solomon is and all that, but I don't think the wisdom literature is. But I could be myth taken on that. And you know, go ahead and call me out in the comments below. While you're down there, go ahead and hit the subscribe button if you're part of the 20 to 30% of people who are not yet subscribed. Hit that bell notification in case, you know, YouTube decides to do its job and let you know whenever I post videos. And what else? Hit that like button, because that appeases the algorithmic gods of YouTube. All hail the algorithmic gods of YouTube. That's all that I have for this week. Next week for Christo-Pagan Sunday, we are doing some spell work, biblical spell work, or biblically inspired spell work. So I'm going to dive into some verses, and we're going to find some verses that we can use in spell work, and maybe how we can set it up and whatnot. So join me then, and until next time, may you have love, hugs, and ladybugs. Bye-bye.